Everybody, Jens Boy 2003 here. What I'm working on today is our 200 yard range. My son and I cut a bunch of trees off going back through the woods about 200 yards. When I walked it and measured it before, it measured a lot farther than 200 yards. It's about 205 where I have our berm set up. What I'm trying to do is clear the firing lane down to it. I've got a stump right here, and I plan on putting another berm a little bit farther behind it, and in front of that berm I was going to put a 100 yard gong, AR-500 gong, as soon as I get the money saved up for it. But we've got to get the stump out first. Tractor's cleared most of the dirt away from it, but some things you just can't help but get your hands dirty. I've really enjoyed using the tractor to clear the place out so I could get down to the berm and build our berm for the 200 yard range, but this is one of four stumps I've had to actually get down and work on by hand. And I'm using my axe and not my chainsaw because I don't want to destroy the chain on it. I've got most of the way through the bottom of that big taproot that goes to China. I'm going to see if we can't get out the tractor. I noticed I've got a radiator leak on the tractor right now, so before we do anything, we're going to take a look at it and see just how bad it is. Let's see whether or not I can keep working and get this stump out. There you can see the radiator fluid dripping down. It's, well, I don't know how well you can see it, but for me moving and bouncing around, the battery came loose and bounced a hole in the radiator. So we've got to get that fixed before we actually get this stump out. Alright, this is what we've got accomplished so far in our 200 yard range. I've cut a swath down through the woods where we cut all the trees off a year ago. My son and I cut them all off. We've got a large dirt pile down there for a berm. You can see a target down there. It's about 100 yards from here to there. And the target is 42 inches wide by 46 inches high. And I plan on putting the paper targets on it. About a foot off the ground, and the targets themselves will be no more than 24 inches across and 24 inches high, and that'll keep all of our shots well below the top of the berm. All right, what I planned on doing right here, let me move the camera a little bit. Right here, I wanted to push all of this dirt stuff up into a pile, and down here on the ground have a 100 yard gong. That way, if you get it shot in just well enough, depending on whatever you're shooting, sometimes you just want to hit a gong. And that's going to be right here for the 100 yard line. The berm up front, we'll go take a look at that after we look at the 200 yard berm. It's 60 yards from our picnic table to it where we're shooting, and it's exactly 205 from my picnic table to the 200 yard berm. You can see we've cleared quite the path down here for the 200 yard berm. There's kind of a hump between the shooting bench and the berm, so I had to take the hump off, and in some places I've cut down over a foot deep to get a straight line of sight. All right, here's our 200 yard target stand. It's, like I said, 42 inches wide, 46 high. It's been painted. Most of the frame itself, 2x4 frame, is pressure treated 2x4s. All of the targets are going to be from here down. I don't plan on putting anything higher than that. I did make it higher so that if I happen to have an errant round go high, it would be easier to see it. The berm is it's probably 8 feet high, well over my head, and it's fairly wide. Behind me there's basically nothing for 1400 yards. So shooting at something this low and they're being unpopulated for 1400 yards behind us, I really don't have too much of a worry about putting anybody in danger. When you're shooting, you want to make sure that you're keeping everybody safe. And a berm like this, I think, will make sure we stop all of our rounds. I also might put a gong beside it. Probably on this side right here, I'll put a small gong on the days when I don't want to check the paper. All right, let's go back to the picnic table we shoot from, and you can get a better idea of the picture of our range. All right, here's the 60-yard berm. This is mainly for handguns and rifle, but I shoot a lot of handguns here. We've got about 35 yards that we can shoot handguns from, and we can shoot from the bench, from our picnic table, and we have a 60-yard berm. The berm is rather large, as you can see. I've paid to have a couple of truckloads of dirt hauled in, and cutting down through the woods for our 200-yard berm, I was able to move a lot of dirt out and put it here on the 60-yard berm. We have a plate rack here made out of 1-inch rebar my son and I welded together before he went to the Navy, with some 3/8 and some 1/2-inch AR-500 steel for shooting at. The 3/8 is good for all handgun rounds, and the 1/2 is good for handguns and rifles. Those were actually, these 2 1/2-inch plates were actually a gift from a friend of mine, and Steve graciously gave me those and helped us set up our rack. The dogs don't like the whistles blowing, so of course they're starting to howl. But the berm is much larger than it was. I was able to make it a lot wider with all the dirt we moved, and considerably higher. So we've got a pretty good range here set up for shooting handguns and rifles. It's particularly fun with AKs, whatnot. All right, let's go back to the picnic table, and you'll be able to see the vantage point of from the shooting bench, looking at both ranges. All right, from the left side of the picnic table, you can easily see the 60-yard berm, the full left and right-hand sides of it. You can see all the targets on it, plates. And this will be the left side of the picnic table, of course, where we'll shoot at the 60-yard berm. And you can also see where I'm gonna put the 100-yard gong. I'll zoom in on that so you can get a better idea of where the 100-yard gong is going to be. Okay, let's go ahead and zoom in. All right, that stump and that pine tree. All right, right in front of that pine tree. And you see where the clay is. You can see the difference, change between the red clay and the gray or topsoil. Well, the gong will be placed there at about that line. It'll be free to swing, and there'll be a dirt pile there about 4 feet high. All right, from the right-hand side of my picnic table, all right, I can see 2/3 of the berm there at the 60 yards, so I can shoot plates. I can still shoot a paper target. And then zooming in, you can also see the tree where we're going to put the 100-yard gong. And zooming even farther down, you can see the 200-yard target. Now, when you think about it, that dirt pile is considerable when our target is going to be on our paper targets are going to be on the bottom of our stand. So we'll be in good shape there. Still have a little more dirt I want to plane off, grade off down through there. But we've got to get our radiator fixed first.
been a week since the battery came loose in our tractor and knocked a hole in a radiator. I had looked at a couple different ways of repairing it. I looked at the JB Weld that they make for radiators and water tanks. I didn't want to use an epoxy. I know a lot of people might have used it, might last a long time, but I didn't want to use an epoxy. I had looked at the aluminum soldering kits you can buy. Muggy Welding sells some. The cheapest kits they have is $60 just for the aluminum soldering kits. They have one where the aluminum solder melts at $350, one at $600. And that was a lot of money. Let me just see if I can take it local and have a professional repair it and see what they can do with it. Called one company and they said it's $130 to patch it. And they might not be able to patch it. It might be too difficult to weld the area where it's damaged. They didn't guarantee that they could fix it. So I called another guy in Carrollton, Ricky Preston of Preston Radiator Services, and he said, bring it by. He says, I'll take a look at it and see what we can do. So I got the radiator out of the tractor, took it up there, and I'll show you here the damage that was on the radiator. You can see the cooling fins, the cooling tubes were damaged, and there were actually two leaks he found when he pressurized it and submersed it into the water tank he has. Well, that's one of the reasons why I didn't want to try to do it myself. I have no idea where on it exactly it's leaking. There was one leak, pretty good size leak, and another one he found, which was a pinhole leak, and I probably never would have seen that on my own until after I got it in, and it was running in the tractor, and then you'd see a seep. It was a pinhole. And the area of damage is quite large, and you can imagine me trying to buy the aluminum solder and then go up and down the area of the tubes that are damaged. It's about a 2-inch area. You know, one small little spot that's damaged is one thing, but trying to hit a large area like that with a torch, and it just seemed like a lot to do. So that's why I took it to Preston Radiator Services. In this picture, you can see he's using a coil of plastic. It looks like plastic wire. And I asked him what it was and if it was some sort of plastic. And he said it was a glue. And I asked him, I said, well, what's the longevity of that? How long will that last? And he just smiled and said he's never had a complaint yet. And I asked him how long he had been repairing radiators. And he's an older fella. He said he had been working on them for 40 years. And as a matter of fact, his shop was up for sale. He said he couldn't give it away. But that's what we had done. We had the plastic repair done on it. And you can see in this picture here what it looks like. He had to go back and hit two of the tubes. The second time we found the pinhole leak. The first leak was leaking so bad, blowing so many bubbles out, you couldn't even see the second one. But that's it. Now we've got the radiator back in. I went over the area of the tubes. I know I didn't. I said I didn't want to use JB Weld to repair it. But I did go over the area that he did with JB Weld, and I did go over a couple of tubes that had damaged and they weren't leaking with the JB Weld. And it's just, I think JB Weld Quick Weld. It wasn't the special stuff for radiators, the high temp stuff. We're going back together and we're going to get this thing fixed, but that's what we did to fix the hole in our radiator. I just wanted to give you guys that update and let you know what was going on with it. So that's that. Why I didn't buy a new radiator, you know, my first thought was, well, $150-$200, this is going to cost me for a new radiator. They don't make aftermarket radiators for tractors. Not all tractors, anyway. Maybe Ford 8Ns, but not Kubotas. They're too recently made. There's so few of them sold that there isn't a market. New radiator from the factory, $700. from your dealer. And you can look, you're not going to find one a whole lot cheaper than that. So that's why we went with it. And where Ricky repaired it, if I ever have trouble with it again, I can scrape that stuff off and go back again with some of the aluminum solder. So it's not a big deal. It's not a something that's going to prevent it from being repaired with an aluminum solder or something later in the future. But anyhow, that's how it was fixed. We're going to go back together and I'll finish getting that stump out up at the range. Alright guys, thanks for watching Jens Boy 2003 Hands on Guns. I wanted to keep you updated with what's going on. I haven't dropped out of existence. I've just quit uploading certain videos. Gunsmithing videos we can't upload anymore. YouTube's already deleting mine. And they don't want gunsmithing videos online. But I have been working on other things, and this range is one of them. This picnic table came from Pennsylvania. We brought it down last summer. My dad gave it to me. It's an old one that has sat at my grandmother's house for years before she passed away. It's an old fiberglass table, and it really doubles really well as a shooting bench. That's it, guys. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned. I'll be uploading videos as I have an opportunity to review products and have some range time. And I have to be choosy about what types of gunsmithing or how-to videos I upload as well, because violating the terms of service will cause them to get deleted and you'll get strikes. And of course, you know how things have changed with YouTube. All right, thanks for watching, guys. See you next time.